Welcome to the event. We're celebrating Steve Klepper and the life of innovation. My name is Paul Fishbeck. I'm the acting department head in social and decision sciences, which was Steve's home department for many, many years. I'm here to act as sort of the master of ceremonies. I will do a brief introduction, and then we have 19 speakers covering four different themes from Steve as a scholar, as a teacher and a mentor, as a program builder, and as a colleague. And so it's going to be a full evening, I guess, or late afternoon. So let's really enjoy Steve. My job is to first summarize sort of Steve's presence here at Carnegie Mellon. He has 3 degrees, all from Cornell in economics. His bachelor's was in 1970, his master's in 72, and his PhD was in 75. After graduation, he went to SUNY Buffalo, where he spent about 6 years. And then we discovered him, and he came here in 1980 as a visiting associate professor. That lasted 1 year, and then he joined our tenure track. And he was an assistant professor from 81 to 84, associate professor from 84 to 91, and then full professor from 91 on. He joined the social and decision sciences department upon arrival, and he was acting head from 1993 to 95. And I will talk about that time period in just a minute. He had a joint appointment with the Tepper Business School after 2001, and he earned a chair, the Hamerschlag Professor of Economics and Social Sciences, in 2003. I really want to note that he won 3 teaching awards. He was a fantastic teacher. He won the College Award in 85, he won the University Award in 97, and then he won the Tepper Business Lifetime Teaching Award in 2001. His impact on all of the undergraduates through his principles of economics is incredible. And I'm sure we'll hear stories about that as well. But what I want to do is drop back to his 2-year tenure as acting head. As an economist, one of the things that annoyed Steve was that we had free coffee in the department. And so on Black Roast Friday, Steve came in and immediately started charging people 25 cents per cup. And what happened was there was a sharp decline in the amount of coffee consumed in the department. I'm acting head now, and I've done this for about 3 or 4 months, and I found a box of old receipts from that time period. And I can measure the impact that this had on the consumption of swizzle sticks, and it's amazing. So what happened was coffee declined by about 3/4, cups declined by about 80%, and swizzle sticks declined by 90%. Right? Why is that? It turned out that the coffee drinkers who like to have cream and sugar were massively affected by this. If you were an addict and liked your coffee black, you were unaffected by the 25 cents. So what happened? Well, it turns out that following Steve's sort of theme about looking at what the impact is of these changes on the industry, what happened? This opening, right? This opening of all these unsatisfied coffee drinkers, where did they go? Well, it turned out that a new entrant discovered this sort of opportunity. And it turns out that 3 months after Black Roast Friday, the first Starbucks opened in Pittsburgh. It's true. It's absolutely true. And Starbucks managed to increase, they had 100% increase in the year following, they had 100% increase in the number of outlets that they were serving. So Steve not only studied, right, the shakeout of industries, he became part of it. And the very coffee that you drink today at Starbucks is in large degree an effect of Steve. Enough of that, I guess. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with Sergei Brzezinski is going to speak about Steve as a scholar.
Thank you. It's great honor and great privilege to be talking about Stephen's scholarship in a setting like this and with so many people who know his research so well in the audience. I feel tremendous responsibility. I came to CMU 6 years ago and started working with Stephen, learning a lot both from him and about the way he did his research. Even though he started as a theoretical econometrician, in his last recorded interview, which he gave me exactly 1 week before his untimely passing, he actually reflected on his switch from theoretical econometrics to industry evolution. And he made it very clear that while he was still very proud of his work in econometrics, that was not where he saw his best skills laid. So lied. What he told me, and I quote, "Once I got tenured, I decided that I really needed to focus on what I thought my skills were, where my skills lay best, and that was industry evolution." So that, I think, partly answers Connie's question that she asked earlier today. By industry evolution, Stephen meant a broad rubric to capture a very large set of ostensibly diverse pioneering studies, but they were all linked, as many people here know, of course, but I want to emphasize this once again, by one strong grand design, and there was a very strong logical connection across all those areas of Stephen's scholarship. So I think that we need to always keep this in our mind as we develop Kleppernomics and nanoeconomics further. So what I'm trying to offer today is my own take on how Stephen took his steps towards nanoeconomics, how his scholarship evolved and became deeper and deeper embroiled in these nanoeconomics. So as we all know, nanoeconomics involves digging below the microeconomic level to understand the evolution of industries. And the first dig was the Gorton Klepper 1982 paper, where they introduced firm heterogeneity into industry growth framework. So as I already alluded to in my morning presentation, there are two things that characterize neoclassical growth theory. One is this concept of a representative or ex-ante identical firms, and the other is technology transmission through a disembodied externality. So firm heterogeneity was where Stephen first diverged from this line of economic analysis. There was intrinsic heterogeneity by birthright, with the work that he did with Ken Simons, and there was this accumulated non-transferable firm-specific knowledge that amplified this heterogeneity over time, the work that he did with Wes Cohen in particular. It is also worth noting that at this early stage of Stephen's own scholarly evolution, innovation diffusion is still almost instantaneous. There's really no direct challenge yet to the externality idea. That would come next. And the way it came next, again, looking back at the interview he gave me, was that he could not feel completely satisfied with his own grand idea, even though he was very proud of his 96 paper and said that it brought him a lot of respect. He kept looking at the same time at the laser industry, not seeing the shakeout and being enormously bothered by that. So in the end, he decided he needed to deepen his understanding of industry evolution, so that led to the submarket theory of industry growth done jointly with Peter. Perhaps even more importantly, it led to, through work with Sally, it led Klepper Stephen to realize that there's another heterogeneity by birthright, which is spin-offs from the best firms, were actually even better than diversifiers from the related industries, and they were the ones that became really the best firms. So that naturally led to trying to understand what drove spin-offs and what drove employee entrepreneurship. What Stephen had to do here is, first of all, to brush aside transaction costs and incomplete contracts, which still pervade most economists' thinking in this regard, because he saw a much bigger issue here through his meticulous data work, that most spin-offs pursue ideas their parent firm simply chose not to pursue. And that is, of course, the strategic disagreement theory of spin-offs, again, in collaboration with Peter. I think we can characterize this leap in Stephen's own scholarly evolution that deepened his nano understanding of industries as transitioned from Schumpeter Mark II, which is of course large corporations being key to the innovative process, to Schumpeter Mark I, which is Schumpeter the theory of economic development, where there's much more role, much bigger role for individual entrepreneurs. So in a sense, I think Stephen here followed the intellectual evolution that was sort of the opposite to that of Schumpeter himself. As Stephen himself noted, this conjunction of ideas led to his study of economic geography. So I quote here from, again, his last interview, which he gave me. Geography, he said, encompasses everything. It encompasses most economic mechanisms. Here, Stephen drew one final demarcation line between his nanoeconomics and neoclassical growth theory. Now he discarded also the disembodied externality view. So ideas instead are transmitted through mobility of talent, not as a disembodied externality. And that, of course, was a direct challenge to prevailing economic geography approach and agglomeration economies. It is great firms that act as involuntary but superb training grounds for founders of new great firms, and these simply tend to cluster together. It is innovation through spin-offs and diversity that are the key to the growth of regions, not agglomeration economies. So the Krugmans and Glaziers of the world cannot continue to preach their gospel once this fundamental insight is appreciated. Unfortunately, Stephen got sick before he could really prove his point. But the last paper he co-authored, the one with Russell Goldman, which he just outlined in the last presentation during the conference, and all of us who were around Stephen know how much joy and excitement he derived from this paper in the last few months of his life. So in this paper, he brought all those his ideas together. There is the new submarkets, there is the diversity. Most importantly, there is this strong complementarity between innovativeness, clustering, and growth of firms in a cluster. So here, I think, is where Stephen's research came full circle. He's back to industry evolution and firm growth theory, but it is now greatly enriched by his deep research in nanoeconomics. I think that the most important thing to sum up about Stephen's scholarship that we can say is that the greatest things still remain to be said. Schumpeter, when he described Alfred Marshall's contribution to economics, said, "Behind the great achievement, there is a still greater message." And more than many other economists, I think, again, using Schumpeter's words, Stephen pointed beyond himself. Unfortunately, it is now left to us to push further the horizons that he opened up with his ideas and to carry forward the torch of nanoeconomics. So what I want to do finally is just to put up the message to young scholars from his interview, which the question was, what kind of advice do you have for young scholars? And the answer is a little bit lengthy, so here are the most important points from this answer. Just pursue something that you think is really important, and that's what should guide your work. You've got to think that you are doing the next revolutionary thing until you get right there at the end of finishing it, and then you have to take a more sobering look at what you have done so that you're at least self-critical. But just pursue what you find to be fascinating. I think that's the message that young or old, we should all try to adhere to. Thank you.
Next, we're going to have 9 talks about Steve as a teacher and a mentor. First is Ashish Thakra, please.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here today to be able to discuss Stephen's impact on his students as teacher and mentor. There was always something old school about Stephen's teaching. One course, one semester each year. No mic, only his booming voice to lecture over 120 students. He signed us up for print subscriptions to the Wall Street Journal. He wanted to know us, inviting each of us in his class to get lunch with him over the course of the semester. And he didn't use PowerPoint slides, only a blackboard, with little concern about being covered in chalk dust the rest of the day. I thought these were just quirks when I took his class my sophomore year. This was Econ 101, Principles of Economics, lovingly known as Kleppernomics, here at CMU, and I enrolled on a lark, having heard little about it from my home in CFA here at the School of Music. 3 weeks in, I dropped the class. I knew I wasn't ready for the first of those legendary exams, and so I waited until the next year when I had more time in my schedule. When I actually stuck with the class the following year, I found I was challenged in a unique way by that old school teaching style. Stephen pushed me to develop economic intuition, not just to memorize facts. He trained us to think like economists, even though he knew many of us would choose careers in different fields. And the thing is, it worked. When I'm struggling to understand the acid-base balance of the kidney in my med school class, I'm thinking back to struggling through his problem sets and the way he taught us to start with first principles and then carefully reason through their implications. Concepts Steve taught us, like marginal utility, opportunity cost, and market efficiency, are integral to the lens I use to read current events and think about public policy and service. And looking around this room, I know I'm not the only one. It's proof of how successful Stephen was at that most radical old, at that most radically old school part of his philosophy. His goal was that classic goal of higher education, a goal that's almost trite because of how often it's paid lip service, yet rarely achieved. He taught us new ways of thinking. It wasn't until I was a teaching assistant for him that I started to see just how he accomplished this through his class. Two components to his teaching always stuck out to me. He was obsessive in his passion for asking the why questions, and he always made it personal. Look at how he designed those tests. 20 to 25 true-false questions with a short explanation for each. I doubt you'll find an education expert who'd recommend that sort of test. But the thing is, it worked for him. It worked for him because he was less concerned with the true and false in the answer sheet and more concerned with the explanation. As TAs, he taught us to look at how the students thought about each question to test the reasoning behind why each student wrote what they did. And if a student performed poorly, he invited that student to his office for a one-on-one meeting, and he made it personal. How do you approach learning new material, he'd ask. Do you test yourself? Do you preview the material before a lecture? By getting to know each student personally, he helped train us in study skills that we could use for the rest of our lives. And it was the same with his research. He was always asking why, and he was always focused on the personal. I worked with him as a research assistant for 2 summers, and I remember once when trying to understand Japanese TV receiver companies and how they made a faster transition to semiconductors than their American competitors, Stephen told me not only to look at trade journals, but also to read memoir of Sony's founder. It was a surprising suggestion, but it captures his approach. He was guiding me to reject easy explanations, and he instead pushed me to collect that evidence by self by looking at individuals and their stories. And so 2 summers as an RA, 2 semesters as a TA, and 1 1/5 times through Kleppernomics. I wish I could say his wit or fashion sense rubbed off on me, but as he liked to say, no luck. Instead, I feel shaped by the high standards he set for everyone, especially himself. He expected a lot from his students, and because of that, economics is the primary lens I use to see the world. Whenever I'm learning a new subject or conducting research, I'm inspired by his deep respect and critical thinking. And if I'm lucky enough to one day teach, I hope to always get to know students as individuals, no matter how large the classroom or lecture hall. He cared deeply about his students and about his research, which is to say about understanding the world and sharing that understanding with others. And I feel immensely privileged to have had him as a teacher and mentor. Thank you.
And now we have Shripal Shah.
Hello. Thank you very much for having me here today. So one of the first thoughts that came to my mind when I heard the news of Professor Klepper's passing was, what about his students? What would happen to the students that would take principles of economics, but they wouldn't get the full Kleppernomics experience? And as odd as it may seem, that was the first thought that came to my head. That was the same thought of a lot of my friends at the same time. And so looking back now, it wasn't that odd, and today I want to convey to you why that is. My name is Shripal Shah. I'm a 5th-year computer science student here, and I took principles of economics during my first year, and I was actually a TA as well for the course during my 2nd year. Teaching was one of Professor Klepper's strongest passions, and he devoted an incredible amount of energy and time towards it. As one of the few people here today who were his students, I feel it's my responsibility to try to convey that passion that he had, as well as that impact that he had on his students, from my perspective. So there were certain aspects of his class that made it so unique and effective. One of those were the experiments. So he would have these in-class simulations which would teach us about economic principles like supply and demand or monopolies and how they worked. So he would give us some basic setup. He would give us maybe everyone has some number of goods, and they sell at some price, buy at some price, and he would just let the experiment run, and we'd look at the results. And so in the end, he wouldn't really teach us, he wouldn't tell us this is how supply and demand works. We would actually experience it, and we partook, and we naturally saw that occur. And then he also, of course, had, you know, like any other class, weekly problem sets. We had quizzes to test our understanding of what was happening, exams, as Ashish mentioned, that really forced you to understand the material. And so from this teaching model, a few themes I saw emerged. One was that hard work is essential, and hard work was rewarded well. I failed the first quiz in that class, and after that, I knew I had to work a lot harder, go to office hours, talk to my TA, spend extra time studying. And as a result, I understood the material better, and I ended up doing better in the class. Another observation I made was that Professor Klepper, he didn't just teach his students, he really made sure that they learned. He wouldn't just let students fall through the cracks. If someone didn't perform well on an exam, he would make sure to meet them in his office, say, what are you doing to study? How are you preparing yourself? And make sure that student progressed. And if they did and they improved, he would drop their lower score, because his goal was watch his students succeed. And so I can talk a lot more about the structure of his class and how he taught, but it doesn't really get to the heart of why he was such an impactful instructor. I think it was just because he really cared. He loved what he was doing, and he wanted to make sure that his students succeeded. And in order to do that, he created a sort of an environment of support and encouragement and growth and learning. And that's something that I think we should definitely, that we definitely miss now, but we should definitely look to as an example in the future. Thank you.
Charles Jacobson.
Thank you very much. This is, I'm an historian by training, so I think I'll structure my 3 minutes and 50 seconds, some odd that I have. Historically, by basically from what I met Steve and through some of the impacts it's had on my life, which have been many. I came to Carnegie Mellon as a graduate student back in 1982, which was more years ago than I care to think. And I first encountered him teaching what is definitely Kleppernomics. I believe the class title was Policy Analysis, but it's a long time ago, so forgive me if I'm wrong. And what I'd like to leave most is my impressions, really, of him as a teacher. He was incredibly lucid, incredibly straightforward, would ask very, very basic questions. He was formidable, yet approachable. And I came away from that class with hopefully some knowledge of some basic economic concepts and public policy issues presented by markets and market failures. We kept in contact after that in graduate school when I was knocking around looking for a dissertation topic. Steve actually approached me with what I think of, again, is actually a very characteristic kind of Stephen Klepper question. It's kind of naive, really. There are different kinds of, there are different industries where that at least superficially present the same kind of natural monopoly market failures. I'll leave the discourse of what that is for later. And yet public policy towards them has evolved very differently. In water supplies, we usually get our water from a city or from a government. For cable television, which is economically, in the wonderful language of economics, fairly simple, similar, we have the wonders of dealing with Comcast. It was very straightforward, simple question. I remember when we talked about it at the outset, him saying something like, well, you know, this might become a focus of your career and interest for a really long time. And I remember kind of scoffing at that, saying, nah, not really. It's a nice dissertation topic, but it'll, you know, I'll move on to other things. As it turned out, I was wrong. He was right. The dissertation itself was involved what, for myself, was a really fascinating exploration into the nitty-gritty micro-history, nano-history of relationships between some public utility firms and government agencies and how those played out over time, how that played out. And it was a lot of fun. And also, I used a lot of economic analysis of, you know, market failures, transaction costs, information asymmetries, all sorts of good stuff like that. It was a lot of fun. That's the short version. Since then, my career has in some ways gone in different directions. I do basically history for lawyers now. But in my work on environmental history, business government relations, relationships between government agencies and businesses, I find myself using the toolkit I got from my work with Steve a lot. It comes in, I don't use the language very often, but I use the concepts very, very frequently, especially things like information asymmetry, which is some people knowing more than other people. It's very handy. Finally, really two final thoughts. One, this is in the legal environment, one gets deposed by hostile attorneys every once in a while, people working for the other side. Thanks in part to my work with Steve, not a problem. The other is, and this is more serious, is I know when I do my own writing, teaching, I always wonder, you know, what its impact will have, how it will affect people. And I know I can say that Steve's work affected me. Thank you.
Daniel Holbrook.
I met Steve in a typical history graduate student situation. I had no money and someone told me he did. Steve and Wes put me to work on a month-long project that involved researching innovation in five industries: semiconductors, automobile tires, pharmaceuticals, automobiles, and one other I couldn't recall, but I think Ken has reminded me was probably television. So there's the first thing we know about Steve as a mentor. He expects a lot. It quickly became clear that doing all that in 1 month was not possible, and that the semiconductor industry's history offered a lot of potential. When I reported that, he quickly agreed to drop the other industries. Apparently he dropped them on Ken. Expand the project's timeline and get some funding. So here's the second thing we know about Steve as a mentor. He trusts the judgment of his students. Not blindly, of course. On that year-long project, we met every week, sometimes every other week. There's those high expectations again. For one meeting, I knew I had not done anything worth reporting on. We met anyway. A very short meeting. There's another thing we know about him. You can't BS Steve Klepper. I don't know why he even tried. I'm not an economist. I'm a historian like Charlie. This project was an out-of-discipline experience for me. While I had to learn, for example, what heteroscedasticity meant, and maybe how to pronounce it, Steve sometimes had to puzzle out why I was moving in certain directions or why I needed so much time in the archives. Clearly, he had an easier time than I did in this regard. But here's thing four. Steve clearly appreciated history and, more broadly, clearly understood the value of interdisciplinarity. One of the ways we acknowledge our mentors is to pass on the advice they gave us. Stephen once told me that if you really wanted to understand something, you had to read it seven times. I'm sure I gave him the same slack-jawed look of incredulity that my students give me when I pass that piece of information on. But here's thing five. In guiding his students, Steve, much more often than not, was correct. I tell my students five. I don't want to lose them. We're here honoring Steve as a teacher, a scholar, a mentor, and a colleague. I want to add something to that list that I think informs all of these. Steve as friend. When I met my now wife here, she had two small children who were, shall we say, occasionally a bit of a puzzle to me, and as small kids are, sometimes frustrating. And Steve, over the course of a few conversations, as a friend will, gave me the benefit of his experience. I guess I'd boil it down in this case to remember kids are people too. I know I'm grateful for that piece of advice, and I'm going to tell my kids they should be too. Much of his research revolves around the building, maintenance, and sharing of knowledge within and among individuals and groups, a collective human enterprise. And though it goes largely unacknowledged in the literature or the literatures, that enterprise is based on some fundamental level on friendships of various sorts. I bet all of us here consider Steve a friend. Let's not forget that important aspect of his legacy.
Sally Sleeper.
Wow. So, Daniel, when you started yours, I had a similar sort of meeting with Steve. I actually met Steve through a mutual friend because I was looking for work. And he said, no, I can't hire you. You need to be a graduate student. I said, no, I need a job. I can be a researcher. You know, this is what I do. And he said, no, you really should be a graduate student. And that started that whole sort of path. So Steve is a researcher. We've talked a lot about that today, looking at industry evolution and innovation. One of the things that we know from his delving deep into all of these industries is we know that he can culture penicillin. We know that he can probably build a laser. And we know he can construct a tire. That's how deep he goes into those technologies. He can actually dissect it. I was tasked with learning laser technology. He bested me. There was nothing I could do to sort of like one-up him. He was always a step ahead. As a teacher, we've heard that he was devoted. I was his head TA for a lot of years, and I saw the time that he put in. And I know that he rewrote those notes every semester. And he worked with the students, and he would not let anybody, as we heard, fall through the cracks. And he worked with his TAs, and he wouldn't let them go unprepared. I mean, he was just that good. And so he won a lot of awards, and we heard about that. One of the things that I also know is Kleppernomics is dispersed in our society. I actually rented my apartment in DC, sight unseen, over the internet, which you're never supposed to do, because I had a phone call with the person who owned the apartment, and he was a student of Klepper. Once we connected on that level, I could send my check through the mail, being thousands of miles away, and know that we were going to be all right. And we actually talked several times that when I was his tenant, and Steve is a person that he really knew, and somebody who really had a big impact on his life. Steve made a lot of impressions on people. But Steve is a mentor where I wanted to focus. He gave that same level of dedication to his grad students as to his research and his teaching. I owe him much for that. He had a clarity of purpose that comes from absolute dedication to understanding how and why events fit or don't fit to his theories. I learned from Steve the need to dig deep and to understand the anomalies and to find the exceptions and the reasons behind those in order to understand better those regularities. And to argue more vehemently for those regularities because I really understood them. So I've really acquired in my current position, maybe even before that, the reputation of being opinionated. I blame Steve. I really think it's so in my current job, I really drew deep. It's with, some of you have heard today, it's with the Department of Defense. I do industrial policy. And that it's all because of Steve. It's from that base of knowledge that I had, and I was able to build on that and have the confidence to go in and think that I could really make a difference and will make a difference because I'm looking at the kinds of deep dives that Steve really worked on. And I'm being successful. And this is in no small part due to the rigorous training that Steve pounded into me. And it has, so that I have the conviction to know how to assess the problem, institute an approach, and validate those results. And so Steve has made an impression on my life.
Ken Simons.
I'm grateful to have found Stephen as a research advisor. At Carnegie Mellon, as a new PhD student, I looked around for a faculty member to work with, and Stephen's work in industry dynamics fit my background in computational modeling of social and economic change, and his suggestion to research industry shakeouts piqued my interest. I threw out a theory. He explained it did not work. I would soon learn he already knew rather well how industries worked. He just needed to prove it. I never experienced Stephen's undergraduate teaching, nor was I a teaching assistant at Carnegie Mellon. I did sit in on his course in structural equation modeling. It was eye-opening in its generalization of regression modeling, albeit linear, and I loved the approach. It was very much about technical methods, and I took to it particularly well, he told me. Really, though, my experience was about research, about learning a research approach. Immersed in research, I was a total nerd, and Stephen appreciated that. He claimed initially he did not usually meet much with PhD students, but was meeting a lot with me because I was progressing rapidly. From what I saw, however, he was not at all stingy with time for future PhD students. We met frequently whenever needed to discuss emerging results, data challenges, and conceptualization. And these intense dialogues and discussion and debates were a great pleasure and helped clarify many ideas for both of us. I remember the day that we both figured out an important characteristic of Jovanovich and McDonald's model. And he made me explain first so that he could check out my explanation and make sure I was on the ball. His approach to research was to pick up a big, important topic, something that really matters to the world, but was not yet well understood. Then the work would begin, real work, to dig into the facts and to get the answer right. He thought widely and non-conventionally. A surface impression was not good enough. If you had not thought through the theoretical underpinnings, you had not understood a phenomenon. Without deep thinking about how processes work, your impressionistic conclusions could be completely wrong. He told me he had long thought of researching industry shakeouts by studying them historically. As I delved into hard detective work about industries and firms, he also started to read many of the enlightening books and articles that I brought in for my study. This yielded a distinctive approach to researching industries and technologies, a sort of micro approach, nano we're calling it here, in which one would seek out information on the specific companies, technologies, and people in the industry. This microeconomic understanding and data gave rich insight into how industries and the economy work. Insight translated into new papers and new lines of research, including a potential revolution in how we think about geographic agglomeration in the economy. Stephen had a knack for turning these insights into productive research publications. One day, his colleague, my professor John Miller, came to me with an idea for how shakeouts could be happening. I pointed out to John how that idea did not work and could not be causing shakeouts. I thought that was it, but John went and talked with Stephen, and the result was a publication by Stephen and John showing evidence against John's theory of shakeouts. That outcome taught me a lesson. Although Stephen and I published 5 joint papers and our experiences and work informed and supported a series of later research that we finished independently, the personal insistence to get research right and to answer big questions, to find the heart of a cause and prove it with data, inspired and continues to inspire me to drive a research agenda on what propels industries and what fills the fount of economic growth. To paraphrase a famous poem, Stephen and I, dressed in nano, danced around a stump. Ahoy, aho, ahoo, we cried, celebrating the marriage of insight and argument. We can all celebrate his legacy. Thank you.
Guido Bernstorff.
Quite likely, I'm the only one in the room who owes his entire career to an elevator pitch with Steve Klepper. In 2002, I was just about to finish my PhD, but unfortunately, I had forgotten to learn any research skills. So it was a pretty hopeless case for academia, and I was quite aware of that, but I had one last chance. I had a postdoc grant to stay a year in the US. And I knew that I wanted to spend that year working with Steve. The problem was, he obviously didn't know me, and I had nothing to impress him with. But I met him at the Schumpeter Society meeting in Gainesville, Florida, literally in the elevator. And that was my opportunity, and I seized it. Well, to be honest, my elevator pitch was a bit too long. It extended into the long line at the lunch buffet where Steve couldn't get away. I mean, he was trapped. And a couple of months later, I came to Pittsburgh, and over the next 12 months, he would spend an incredible amount of time and effort to turn me into something resembling a researcher. So there were very many things I learned from him. And I cannot possibly list them all. I quickly realized that I would never match his analytical skills. What was much harder to accept was the following. Even after I had spent month and month researching the histories of some obscure tire firms in Ohio, it all too often happened that we would discuss the history of some particular firm and would disagree about some detail. And let me tell you, almost always it was Steve who was right about it. Among the things that I learned from Steve is how much effort it takes to turn a good idea into a paper. I looked up the version numbers of the two major papers we did, and the version numbers I have on my hard disk are 84 and 102. You have to know that we renamed one of the papers halfway, so that would be 3-digit as well. That conveys the wrong impression, though. Working with Steve always was incredibly fun for me. There were a number of reasons for that, but I think the most important reason, and I think that is the most important legacy that I got from Steve, is that he always loved the research he was doing. He was genuinely interested in this. He was always enthusiastic. When I would return from Akron, say, "What did you find?" And it was always, I don't think he ever wrote a paper because there was some strategic opportunity to do that. I'm not sure he would ever have counted his citations or something like that. And I think in a world where these kinds of behaviors are getting more and more important, that's really something very important. Okay, so today I am proud and I'm grateful to be a Steve Klepper spin-off. My most important routine probably in my work is to ask the following question: what would Steve have done, and try to do the same, which is much in line with his theory of spin-offs, and which I think is very beneficial not only for me, but also for my students. I wish I could have given a bit more back. I think the only thing that Steve ever learned from me was to pronounce the name of his chair. Thank you.
Atsushi Oyama.
Okay, so my name is Atsushi Oyama. I came here from Japan to attend Stephen Klepper conference and memorial events. When I met Stephen for the first time, I just finished my PhD study at SUNY Buffalo and just started my postdoc position at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. So Sergey and Rashley connected me to Stephen, and that led me to write a joint paper with Sergey and Stephen. And thinking back, it was good timing of working with Stephen because it's not like, you know, student and teacher relationship. So he treated me as an independent researcher, and at the same time, I was young and eager to learn from Stephen. In fact, there was no fight between Stephen and me, and I learned a lot about how to do good research from writing a joint paper with Stephen. So I'd like to share with you three lessons I learned from Stephen. The first lesson I learned Stephen is try something new. So his advice was to ask and answer a research question nobody has asked before, or answer a question in a totally new way if somebody has already asked. I have this advice in mind when I start a new project. The second lesson I learned from him is good empirical research requires rigorous theoretical examinations. Before I met Stephen, I thought Stephen liked digging into the data, but I didn't expect he would spend much time on theoretical aspects, and I was not right. So after working with Stephen, I found that his empirical analysis was supported by careful and rigorous theoretical thinking. And last and not least, actually the most important thing I learned from Stephen is I should care about research of people around me. I got this lesson when I saw Stephen making a lot of comments about Sergey's paper. And Sergey told me, oh, this is not the first time Stephen made a lot of comments about his paper. And also, he told me that this is what Stephen usually did for his student and his colleague, if requested, even if not requested. But this made me realize the importance of having a good research community and what work ethic is, what professional attitude is. I'm now based in Japan, and I have met a lot of Japanese scholars who are influenced by Stephen's academic work. And I'm trying to pass the lessons I learned from Stephen over to my students and colleagues in Japan. I was so lucky to have had the opportunity to work with Steve. Thank you.
Ariel Klepper.
Hi, I'm Steve's daughter, Ariel. So my father inspires me constantly. Well, how, you might ask. So I think I'll illustrate this by making a parallel to his favorite story. So you might think, knowing, in general, that it could be, oh, the day he met my mom, or the day we were born, or the day he became a tenured professor. Yeah, it was Fairchild's. So for those of you that don't know, Nobel laureate William Shockley directed a group of recent PhD graduates. And they worked on semiconductor devices at Shockley Semiconductor Laboratories. So distaste for Shockley's rigid management style led to dissent amongst the team, then now known as the Traitorous Eight. They left to start a new firm, a spin-off called Fairchild. Several other very successful companies, including Intel, were spin-offs of Fairchild, and they are affectionately referred to as the Fair Children. Myself, a recent PhD grad, I got to thinking about parallels of my father's favorite story and his two best spin-offs, sorry Guido, my brother and I. So there are a lot of similarities. Firstly, there's no debating that my father had a very rigid management style. As far as kids go, our backpacks had to be zipped, ready to go by the door for school every day. Our motivational talks before athletic events always ended in concentrate, be methodical. Our summer jobs were spent in the stacks in the library in Akron, Ohio with Guido, combing through obituaries of executives to trace where they had come from in firms to figure out entrance into the market. So Dad was always meticulously prepared. He would labor over talk outlines before he was scheduled to give them, months in advance. In fact, he even told me 10 years ago, when I was single and finishing up college, that he'd already decided what he was going to say about me at my wedding speech. True to form, when my husband and I were married last year, he said exactly what he drafted in his outline 10 years before. The gist of his remarks were that I basically used my wit to circumvent every practical piece of advice he ever gave me. And, you know, if you know the Klepper legacy of being stubborn, I can testify that the apple didn't fall far from the tree. So, you know, I rejected all this practical advice, so how is it that I make this claim that my father was one of my biggest influences and inspires me every day? It may sound incongruous, but allow me to further explain. Dad never asked us to do anything he wasn't fully committed to himself. Our backpacks were at the door ready for school, but so was his briefcase, meticulously organized and ready to go. He didn't just use the words concentrate and be methodical as a catchphrase. He used that to inspire everything he did and in all his preparation. In fact, when he committed to something, he was always committed to it 100%. Sometimes you wish you got more like 75%, but he didn't know how to do things without being completely and utterly dedicated. And when most people commit to things, maybe it gets half done. You're always going to get 100% with my father. And it's such a rare and unique quality. He lived his word and his principle. He was the best advocate, the best role model, the best encouragement. And it's this dedication that I try and channel every day. It's no accident that I chose to do my PhD. Dad's amazing ability to take and use science to explain the complex and make it appear simple was artful and totally inspiring. However, I do research in a completely different discipline. So to return again to this point, it's not anything about the specifics of what he said or did. In general, it was the way he did it. It's how he did it. As many have pointed out, it's his love, excitement, and devotion for his work that was evident in all parts of his life and made it look like so much fun. I think that any friend of mine that's crossed the threshold to our house can probably explain to you what a spinoff is, and probably in fairly technical terms. And in fact, long before I knew them, both my two best friends and my husband were students in Kleppernomics. So my dad has launched several successful spinoffs. And he's touched and enriched my so many parts of my life because of the kind of man he was. For me, that legacy is with me every day, and I hope to be able to instill that unique brand of dedication, integrity, and inspiration to my own future spin-offs one day. Thanks.
And now we have two talks about Steve Klepper as a program builder. Rashi Agarwal.
So Ariel, that's a very, very hard act to follow. So I'm here to talk to you about community. Gathered here at CMU clearly is the one community that Stephen absolutely loved. It was his intellectual home for sure. Clearly many, many relationships that are evident out here. The other community that represented Stephen's intellectual home is CCC. What does CCC stand for? It's the Consortium for Competitiveness and Cooperation. And this is a community that Stephen founded, fostered, and really has developed into what is now one of the most vibrant set of scholars across institutions all over the world. So the first question, of course, is why? Well, we've already heard about all of Stephen's engagement and investment in ideas. In fact, as one of the few pioneers that realized that traditional neoclassical assumptions really didn't work, Stephen found himself at a loss on how he was going to go ahead and develop this further, right? So one of the things that they found out very quickly, these few kindred spirits that are in, if you will, reformed economists, is that in order to truly evolve an intellectual community, there needs to be an investment in junior talent development. And in fact, this was one of the key insights that led Stephen to dedicate the next 20 years of unfaltering, unwavering attention to the mentorship of junior research scholars. So of course, the idea there was that there were only four or five of these people that were spread out across the country and clearly were thinking about innovation, technological change, and entrepreneurship in a manner that economists in traditional economics departments weren't. And so the graduate students of these faculty were not necessarily getting the committee-wide mentorship that they needed. So the bright idea was to let's get them together once a year, immediately after their coursework and they've started to think about their proposal and their ideas, but not so late that they had completed their dissertation. So it was in this formative stage that the doctoral students would come together as a community in front of their peers and the illustrious founders of the CCC, present their work and get feedback. And so was founded the first CCC consortium in 1994. Well, several of us in the CCC community got pretty used to the fact that every year in the opening ceremony of CCC, we heard about that glorious winter, negative 20 degrees, and I think it became negative 30, negative 40, but at one point in time, Stephen even brought this almanac to prove that never before and never after was it so bitterly cold in Pittsburgh. So literally, this is what you would say, a trial by ice or snowstorm that the CCC was inaugurated, right? So Steve was very fond of telling you that story. But if you ask CCC alums, they will tell you another story and relish it just as lovingly. They will call it a trial by fire. Because if you think about your debutante ball, right? This is the first time you're coming out. And you're being Klepperized. Right? In front of this entire audience, you really know how to defend your thought, and you really know how to think about doing good research. Indeed, over the next 20 years, it's precisely this process that has enabled some of the best scholars to now become the leading names at leading institutions in strategy, in innovation management, across some of the top business schools of the world. And each of these come together as alumni, paying it forward. And every year, so usually if you think about it, there's a one-to-one student ratio to faculty ratio, and you're lucky about that. CCC today represents two to three faculty attending for every one doctoral student that's presenting out there. That's truly awesome, a community, and that was created by Stephen. And I stand here in front of you in gratitude for the fact that Stephen asked me to take over the leadership of CCC after he realized that there needed to be a transition. And I've done that very gratefully. I've listened to a lot of his advice that he gave me in the few months before, and I've tried to stay with it. But I not only listened to it, I intend to do a little bit more beyond that. And two things that we're doing as far as CCC is concerned is, one, we're going to go ahead and incorporate it as a nonprofit institution. And part of the reason why is that it truly is an institution that covers so many different faculty at so many different institutions. The other story that Stephen was very fond of saying is that in those 20 years, not only did he invest his effort, his mind, his thought, he also, as he said, became a beggar. Now you might say a beggar, literally begging for money. Inasmuch as once the Sloan Foundation ran out, the funding for that ran out, and before Kauffman Foundation took over with supporting this conference, there were a few years there where the conference was really tight on its budget and shoestring budget. So Stephen literally went around asking the senior faculty to donate money or to give money from their research budget so that the doctoral consortium could be funded. That is the effort, the investment, and the love that Stephen put towards this. The second part that I need to tell you about is that precisely to make sure that this legacy continues on and CCC becomes a supporting institution that is not left at the vagaries of foundations funding or not funding it, we're also creating a Stephen Memorial Stephen Klepper Memorial Fund. And I've spoken multiple times with Florence. She's very supportive of this idea. What you will also see around you is a handout that discusses the CCC, and on the second page is, we're not soliciting any funds, this is really not about that, but if you will, and if you care to fill it out, just there are four questions there that if you could answer for us, that would be very helpful. If you want to just scroll it down and hand it to me at a later point, that's fine. If not, then email it to me. But more than anything else, what I really stand out here in front of you is a very, very grateful member of the CCC community, knowing that it would not be possible, and our intellectually vigorous community would not be possible without Stephen. Thank you.
Francisco Veloso.
So, I'm going to tell you a little bit about program building here at Carnegie Mellon. When I came to Carnegie Mellon in 2002, there was already this program being established. And this was the PhD program in strategy, entrepreneurship, and technological change. And this program features some of these unique characteristics of Stephen that we've been hearing through some of the previous presentations. Because this program really brought together four different schools and departments, SDS at the College of Humanities and Social Sciences, EPP at the College of Engineering, the Heinz School, and the Tepper School. They were all involved in this PhD program. And the importance of this, just as Rajri mentioned, and that's the important thing here, is that it was truly about building a community. And we didn't, you know, we didn't prepare this together. What was important for Stephen as the leadership and the anchor for this program was the issue, was the problems. That was what was important. It didn't matter so much where you come from history, from economics, from engineering, from public policy. It was really about the relevance of what you were looking at, what you were trying to understand, how you were pushing our understanding of industries and their phenomena. What did matter for him was of course, the topics you were choosing, where he was quite particular about what was relevant and what was not relevant in terms of research. And this community was really important, certainly for me as a scholar, but for many of the others that were here, both as colleagues as well as PhD students that went through this program. Later on, he extended this program also across the Atlantic. And it became part of what it is, the Carnegie Mellon Portugal program. We took this program in strategy, entrepreneurship, and technological change and linked it together with an engineering school in Portugal, Instituto Superior Técnico, and with the business school, Católica Lisbon School of Business and Economics, where a few years later I ended up as the dean. You know, vou figure how life goes around. But the important thing, again, when this idea came about, well, across the Atlantic, doing a PhD program, the same features came back, because it's not so much about the distance, just like in the CCC, or the departments, or the areas. It's about the problems and the people that are devoting their energies, their minds, and their efforts to advance this understanding. So what I wanted to finish is just saying that what really mattered here at Carnegie Mellon was this learning environment that Stephen really created and was the anchor for, and this dedication and rigor that several have talked about and was present in students and in faculty. And this community that was created had a long-lasting impression in many of us, several, certainly in myself. When I came here, I was a young assistant professor. And 9 years after that, even after I got tenure, when I sat down with Stephen to work on a problem, to discuss a student that we were jointly advising, I was wondering whether I had gone back to grad school and was starting all over again with Stephen now as my mentor. But I thoroughly enjoyed, because just like many of you, it was pure intellectual and personal relationship that was created through and with Stephen. Thank you very much.
We now have five talks on Steve Klepper as a colleague. This is Joel Tarr.
I prefer to call this section in regard to my remarks friendship, my personal friendship, rather than colleague. Steve Klepper and I were close friends for more than 30 years, sharing many professional and personal experiences and family relationships. In many ways, I thought of myself as an older brother to him who tried to give him good advice. Whether he accepted that or not is another kind of question. But I provided a ready ear for stories about his research, his experiences with students, his teaching, his health, and also his gripes about administrators who shall not be named, about journal reviewers, and about journal editors. When I first met him during his interviews at CMU in 1980, I instinctively sensed that CMU was the right place for Stephen Klepper, that he had the right mix of talent and New York-type chutzpah that would make it possible for him to survive and prosper at the university. I found out that I was completely right. When he was hired by what was then the Department of Social Sciences, now Social and Decision Sciences, we had offices next to each other for 9 years. And we often interacted, carrying on a level of banter that drew upon our shared New York experience. In those days, Steve smoked the foul-smelling French cigarettes called Gauloises. His office was filled with fumes that penetrated into the corridor, where they mixed also with the smoke from my and Pat Larkey's pipes and occasional cigar. Over the years, we all stopped smoking, but the smell of the Gauloises persisted in Steve's office. I often ate lunch with him, and I would beg him, "Open the window, Steve. Please, we need fresh air." He never would open the windows. He stubbornly kept them closed. Another anecdote about his office. Steve had on a shelf a row of copies of the Industrial Census of the United States that went back into the early 20th century. I admired him. I admired him as an economist who thought that time was an important variable. Not a lot of economists thought that, you see. And one day I pulled one of the volumes off the shelf, and I looked in it, and I said, "Oh, this is this University of Buffalo in these. Did you buy these at a library book sale?" And he said, "No, I charged them out." I said, "25 years ago?" He said, "Well," he said, "I never was asked to return them." He said, "Nobody probably wanted to use them." I said, "Steve, you have to return them." And I persisted for a year until he finally did return them. Okay, so one might say he was stubborn. Right? One might say that being stubborn was one of the strongest characteristics of Stephen's personality, be it in research, teaching, social life, sports, clothing, or driving directions. All were pursued with determination and energy and utter conviction. Who could cause him to soften up and to back down from his deeply rooted positions? Probably most of all, his dog, Jasper. Was the element that caused him to back off of fixed positions. Occasionally, his lovely wife, Florence, and even his children might have that kind of effect, but Ariel has testified that it wasn't very, very likely. Of the many experiences that myself and my wife, Tova, shared with Steve and Florence over the years, one of the most memorable was going to the jazz concerts at the Manchester Craftsman's Guild. We always preceded the concert by going to dinner, and Steve always drove the car. Ah, what a memorable experience it was to be sitting in the back seat of Steve's car while he attempted to break all speed records getting to the north side of Pittsburgh from Squirrel Hill. And there was always the question of who knew the best route to get there. Me, a historian who has specialized in the history of Pittsburgh, knows it like the streets like the back of my hand. Well, Steve, of course, you know who is going to win that dispute. So one of the secrets I shared with my wife, though, about the jazz concerts was that I didn't care for jazz so much. What I cared for was a chance to associate a dinner and at the concerts with Steve and Florence. That meant more than anything else to me, and I hated to miss an occasion when that was possible. And also to engage in the kind of repartee that he and I engaged in to such an extent that Florence and my wife Tova would beg us to stop. Now, one of Steve's most admirable traits in my eyes was how much he cared about his teaching. And you've heard a lot about that. And as you know, kleptonomics was a famous CMU course, and Steve a demanding teacher. But Steve is demanding of himself, of course, as well as students. And a number of times I would find him physically sick after a class, actually physically his stomach would be upset because he didn't feel the class had gone well, that he hadn't done a good job. It meant so much to him, as you heard. And obviously there are a few professors at CMU who care so deeply about their teaching. I'm sure that there are other memories that I have of Steve that could be added to these brief comments, but I will conclude by saying that I miss him tremendously, that the university will not soon again see another person of his dimensions. Thank you.
Wes Cohen.
I left CMU 12 years ago, but my most cherished time in academia will always be the 20 years spent here. While I value my friendships from those formative years, I'm especially grateful for the privilege of having been Steve's friend, colleague, and collaborator. The way I have long thought about my relationship with Steve during that time is that we sort of grew up together as academics. He was, however, a few steps ahead of me on the academic timeline, and as a consequence, I often benefited from his counsel as I went through the academic gauntlet. And just as academic brothers might, we supported each other through our most anxious moments about journal rejections, promotions, and our children's teenage years. We even shared the same gastroenterologist who treated us for the same official diagnosis, pre-tenure stress. We also shared great times together. We were there to celebrate each other's journal acceptances, promotions, and babies. Our families also occasionally vacationed together. I fondly remember one trip we all took to West Virginia where Steve was at his single-minded best. On our first day, Steve, Mark Hamlet, and I went out in a rowboat, only to be lectured by Steve on his academic preoccupation of the era, errors and variables. Mark and I both considered jumping ship, but thought otherwise, given the cold, murky water in the distant shore. We, of course, enjoyed the excitement of working together, bouncing ideas off of one another and ruining the narrow-mindedness of economics, but also teasing one another and engaging in a steady stream of practical jokes. It took 2 days before I finally figured out that Steve had hidden my bike in a colleague's storage closet. And then there was the time I told our local grocer, John Ruggieri, that he might want to wish Steve a happy 50th birthday. Despite his numerous protests, Steve never did persuade John that he was, in fact, turning only 48. Our jokes were so much a part of our relationship that when I emailed him congratulations upon his receipt of the Swedish Global Entrepreneurship Award in 2011, Steve responded, I quote from an email, I must admit that when I got the email notifying me of the award, my first instinct was to think you were playing a trick on me. I only believed it was for real when I found their website. I figured you would not go, even you would not go to such lengths for a joke. How will I remember Steve? Aside from his obvious intelligence and drive, I will remember Steve as being what I would call New York blunt, yet gracious, intellectually curious and aggressive, yet supportive. sometimes tough, but always caring in his drive to help others to be as good as they could be. I will end my remarks this evening, as I did at a dinner of the CCC that we heard about from Rashri a little while ago. This dinner honored Steve for his role 20 years before in founding and subsequently leading this organization dedicated to the mentoring of numerous young PhD students. At that time, I said, "Our conversations always made me better. Steve, thank you." And this evening, I will add, "Steve, you will always be in my heart and my mind." Thanks indeed.
Peter Roberts.
So talking about Steve as a colleague, the 100% attention to structure, detail, you would want to say that. 100% commitment to task, you would want to say that. But in talking about my relationships with Steve, which kind of sadly on my part, one project together, one class together, and I'm sad to say that here, one attempt to recruit him away, from Carnegie Mellon. And so the title of my talk is either "I Am Unworthy," right? I couldn't sustain the relationships. For gosh sakes, man, don't look in the back room to describe the kind of things you don't see up at the beginning when you embark on a project with Steve. But I think I'm going to just call this "Thank You, Florence," because of the things that I remember most. So one project together, young colleague, chance to come to Pittsburgh multiple times to work on a project together. They start at 7:30 in the morning, right? And 7:30 in the morning with those yellow sticky notes attached to the bag means that he started, while he slept, right? By about 5:30, and I'm the younger guy, by about 5:30 in the afternoon, I don't remember anything. I don't remember the chalkboard, I don't remember the notes, I remember talking about lunch, I don't remember eating it, right? I just remember the first day coming home going, "Please stop, please stop." And the one thing I do remember is I remember Florence seeing desperate lad, I think the tradition of consuming first a bottle of wine, and I'd onto a second bottle of wine, asking no questions when I started bringing my own wine, to Pittsburgh. I think she understood that this guy's seriously not going to make it. One class together, this was a sweet deal. Carnegie Mellon was going to pay me to come back, lots of money, 7 classes, 4 were going to be mine, 3 were going to be Steve's, good ratio. I don't remember my 4. I think they went well. I do remember the first draft of Steve's first lecture. I remember the second draft of Steve's first lecture. I remember the 3rd, 4th, and 5th drafts of Steve's lecture. I remember trembling, watching him come down the stairs in the morning with what looked like another draft of that lecture. And I don't remember much in terms of how it went, but I do remember at one point in time, and this will always be in my memory, "Steve, for God's sake, leave him alone." Right? And that was Florence, once again. So the idea, and I do go back when I talk about colleagues, the one reason I know that my time with Stephen was important is all the advice I give my students comes from my recollections of working with Steve. And one thing was, it was this intense, and it was a commitment. We tried to recruit him. There was one of my kind of older org theory guys didn't like the fact that we had an economist, because economists obviously didn't read organization theory and didn't understand the details. So I watched this colleague of mine smugly trying to out Steve by saying, "Surely there's a theory in our area, it's called a dominant design theory. I don't suppose you've heard of that." And I just remember the next 25 minutes, being a detailed regalement, right, of how this. And then he made the mistake later, the same colleague, going, "Oftentimes economists don't understand some of the details, some of the stories." Right, and of course this paper was about the auto industry, and I was like, no. So that talk was 25 minutes dominant design, 45 minutes the detail. I think it was an argument between old guys about who what, but it was, and I remember as that process unfolded, the final thing that Florence came over and then said, "Peter, I know you're working hard. Steve will never leave Carnegie Mellon." Right. And actually, at the time you go, shoot, but looking around here right now, that's obviously someone who knows him, very well, and obviously someone knows, what the right thing, was. Steve, belongs, here. This, for me, Carnegie Mellon is Steve. So I want to thank Steve for the lessons, go through. So beneath all that, those, the time working on those two projects, extremely important to me in terms of what I carried forward, but I want to thank the entire Klepper family for just an amazing set of memories. So thanks very much.
Peter Thompson.
I spent only 2 years as a colleague of Stephen, maybe 20 months before I resigned. He's the most important man in my adult life, and it was a very complex relationship. Steve, as we've heard, brilliant, driven. He's also hard. He's hard to work with sometimes. Let me tell you, first of all, how we met. In Vienna at a conference. Really boring conference, full of pompous presentations. He grabs me at 5 o'clock and says, let's go for a walk. Now, I'm a macroeconomic theorist. I've never looked at data. I barely knew who Steve was. I'd never read any of his papers. He'd never read any of mine. I think he was just trying to identify somebody who looked as bored as he was. So we go for a walk. 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock. I'm getting hungry. 9 o'clock. We eat at 10. We get back to the hotel at 12. And as we're at the door, I'm thinking, God, I am tired. He says, let's go walk the other side. 3 a.m. What does a macroeconomic theorist and Steve talk about? Take a guess. Ransom olds, penicillin, television. We didn't talk about macroeconomic theory, I can tell you that much. 2 years later, after that, I moved here for the sole reason to work with Steve. Now, still wasn't my area. I was slowly drifting into that area a little bit more. But I just knew this was going to be special, this was going to be transforming. We only ever wrote 2 papers together. They're the most important things I've ever done. That's not why we bonded, though, because of the work. Where we bonded is something that nobody's talked about, and those of us who, you know, knew and loved Steve well, knew there was a private part of Stephen that wasn't full of confidence and full of aggression. Where Steve and I bonded is we shared the same fears. Do we know enough? Are we up to date on the tools? Am I doing the right thing? That's what I loved about him, somebody who could be so brilliant, yet so modest about themselves, or somebody who can be so unsure, so human, yet achieve so much. And that's really where I got to love Steve, because I generally don't like people who are very successful because they're generally asses. Steve had that humanity that was just incredibly special. Why would somebody like Steve have those doubts? Many of you have heard that about, you know, all the incredibly novel contributions and the new directions for research that Stephen did. It is really tough in economics to go against the grain. It is brutal. And Stephen, if you wrote a paper with Stephen, the paper would get done quite quickly, but you wouldn't publish it for 7 or 8 years, and you would go through brutal insults. I was first introduced to this in the first paper we wrote together on submarkets, which has turned out to be quite a success. We presented it at Tepper. He said, no, you present it. I'm just going to sit there. You should present it. So I presented it. Some bugger at the back stands up halfway through the seminar and goes, what the hell is this? It sure as hell isn't economics, and walks out. I look at Steve. He just grins. He told us last year, only an idiot would have gone to Tepper with a paper like that. That same paper we submitted to a journal, the American Economic Review, the top journal in the profession. The response we got was, this paper sets the field back 50 years. It's nice to have an impact. We submitted it to the next journal, and the response was, I was so irritated by this paper by page 4, I stopped reading. People, in mainstream economics, people were very tough on Stephen, and it took a lot of courage and a lot of persistence to get those ideas out, and so often turn out to be right that eventually the mainstream economists would cite, would make use of his stuff despite being so resistant. Naturally, you get to lack some confidence. You get to worry about whether you're doing the right things. But Stephen always was doing the right thing. I loved him very much.
Kyron Skinner.
So I get to go last, and I've been teared up through many of these presentations, so I think I'll start where I was going to end by telling a story that will probably embarrass Ariel, but I think it'll lighten me up a bit and make me be able to say the things that I really wanted to say. So well before tenure, I was invited by Glamour magazine to its annual women's event. My senior year in college, when I failed to get the Rhodes after making it to the finals, I won Glamour magazine's top 10 college women of the year, and I convinced myself at 19 that this was far more important than the Rhodes Scholarship. There are some famous psychologists here like Baruch Fischhoff who have some theories about how people tell themselves myths. And somehow that myth continued. So when I got the invitation to go to this annual event at Carnegie Hall, I needed a partner in crime, and I got in touch with Ariel. I didn't want Steve to know about it. And we were going to go to this big event, and it got bigger and bigger, and Nicole Kidman was going to be there, and Fergie, and Tyra Banks, and Condi Rice, and so on. So one day I was in the hallway, and I looked a little nervous and concerned, and Steve said, "What's going on? Are you worried about your research, your teaching? Is there a problem?" I said, "No, I don't have enough money for the clothes that I need for this event." And so I told him what we were doing. I didn't know that he knew that Ariel was in the same dilemma. I was hoping she wouldn't tell him what we were planning to do. So he convinced me not to spend a dime. And I rarely take any advice from men, but that time I listened. And he said, "Where would you have?" And he said, "That's the advice I'm giving my daughter." So we both wore what we had, and we had a great night, and I'm here to tell you that we looked better than anybody at that event. If you don't believe me, you can see the photo of us with Fergie, and we looked far better than her that night. It's at their house. So the American university is really unique among all universities in the world. It started at Harvard in the mid-1600s as a response and in some ways an attempt to mimic the universities of both Britain and continental Europe to be as intellectual as they were, to be better at truth. So Harvard started with Veritas, and every Ivy League after it tried to best Harvard with a deeper understanding of truth. The first endowed chair at an American university, I believe, is in the religion department at Harvard, an attempt to have a really deeply intellectual academic experience. But then after World War II, and this is where Steve's work has informed my understanding of the American university, with the post-World War II competition with the Soviet Union and the post-Sputnik era and the infusion of billions of dollars into the American university from the Defense Department and other parts of the national government, the American university became less intellectual and more academic. And we see that even more in the current period where we have Google Scholar, and you can count things more and you can count influence. But the distinct part of the American university is its ability to be intellectual. And that's why what happens in the humanities and social sciences and in the hard sciences like biology and other fields is so important to the future of the American university, even in a technology school like Carnegie Mellon. When those disciplines suffer, the whole society suffers. Our initial entry into education was through the pathway of those disciplines. I say all this to say that some academics are also intellectuals. And Steve Klepper was one of those few academics who was also an intellectual. An academic gets his papers and his books done, but an intellectual moves way outside of his intellectual comfort zone and his or her discipline to have a big impact. It's extremely difficult to be both. It's not a requirement for tenure to be both, but the environment is always enriched by those few academics who are also intellectual. That was, to me, Steve Klepper. When you think about nanoeconomics, it requires of those who study in that area to be serious historians, to understand how to use historical analytical methods, to sometimes become archival researchers. When you look at the body of what Steve did with his time and his work, it focused so much on the intellectual side, a commitment to undergraduate education sadly, is not a requirement to be a great academic, and sometimes not a requirement to be a faculty member at a Tier 1 research university. But Steve took great pride in his undergraduate teaching, and many don't know that he started an undergraduate minor that was among the most interdisciplinary academic initiatives for undergraduates that the university has ever seen. He allowed me to manage it for him for several years after the Kauffman initiative that he cared so deeply about failed. But when you look at how he also operated in the Department of Social and Decision Sciences, he moved beyond an academic. He was one of the few economists who really cared about reading the work of the historians and the political scientists and the others in the department. There's just a lot of evidence that Steve was an intellectual. The reason I think he doesn't get credit for being an intellectual is that, and Florence has said this numerous times, he wasn't ambitious in the way that many public intellectuals were. He wasn't trying to get on television or to write op-eds, but he was fully capable of having been at the top of that part of the intellectual experience. So as a colleague, what I took from him was not just the frugality of don't spend all your money on a new outfit, which was really important for me since I spend so much money on new outfits, but it was also how to try to be an intellectual, not just an academic. So that's my view of Steve Klepper and the impact of him on my life. Thank you.
Now for some final reflecting and closing, our dean.
So first, let me thank again David Hounshell for an incredible labor of love. I think the amount of work merits certainly an application for a sabbatical to the dean, but it probably won't work. So thanks to everyone for coming and for sharing the many ways in which you experienced and obviously treasured Steve. He was clearly an intensely dedicated and important scholar, an intensely dedicated and unusually effective teacher, an intensely loyal and wonderful friend, and an intensely devoted and loving member of a great family. So I want to end the event with a nod to a side of Steve that we have celebrated, but never enough. And that was his sense of humor. And I want to do so because I'm quite sure he would totally approve of ending this sort of event, not by me waxing heroic, but rather by poking fun at him, mercilessly but lovingly. So I want to end this event by reading you a poem I wrote and read to him on his 60th birthday. First, the context. So in about 1998, Steve and I were asked to redesign his department's basic course on research methods and regression. We spent hundreds of hours pouring ourselves into it, developing an astonishing amount of material, some of which David Hounshell recently poured into four large cartons and dumped on my doorstep. As the course approached, I warned Steve that we had far too much material to cover. We were going to overwhelm the students. And after a week or two, already behind, I suggested that we jettison the gory details on how sampling distributions underlie statistical inference. No, he insisted, they had to know it, and I'm going to find a way to include it. I just need to be clever about it. And after showing up for the first few weeks with 14 to 15 pages of handwritten notes and getting through less than half of them each time, I begged him to relent. No, I'm sure I can do it if I just write out the equations ahead of time. Not even close. Finally, I came up with the brilliant idea of betting him a cappuccino each class, the standard betting unit in Baker Hall, that he could not get through even three quarters of the material he had planned. After enjoying free caffeine for a month, I was sure he would relent. No. He was so determined to transfer all of this crucial knowledge to the students and to prove me wrong
but he announced that he was going to extend class 10 minutes beyond the listed ending time. I'm not kidding. The students were aghast, but he assured them that he had looked it up, and because it was the last class period of the day, the 10 minutes from 4:20 to 4:30 were fair game. Needless to say, I never paid for a cappuccino all term, and so to cement the memory in our typical I will tease you until you know I love you humor, I wrote this poem to kid him about it several years later. And it's entirely appropriate for two people like he and I who were brought up a-religiously Jewish in New York City. "'Twas the week before finals, a slightly darker tale than the original. "'Twas the week before finals, when all through the room, not an object was stirring, not even the broom. Assignments were hung by the chalkboard with care, in hopes that the professor would soon not be there. The students were nestled all snug in their chairs, as visions of bivariate regressions pulled at their hairs. The TA in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled down for a long lecturer's nap. When out in the hall there arose such a clatter, I sprang from the chair to see what was the matter. Away to the entrance I flew like a flash, tore open the doors and knocked over the trash. The lights in the hallway of old Baker Hall gave the luster of midnight to students in thrall. When to what to my wondering eyes should appear but a cranky old professor, his lecture notes near. With a boom in his voice, heard clear over at Tepper, I knew in a moment it must be Steve Klepper. To the lecture he strode, to the front of the hall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all, a sheaf of mathematics under his arm like a bill. He just looked just like a dentist getting ready to drill. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry, the students crouched low, each eyed his blackberry. The stump of a chalk peg he held tight in his claw, and the symbols that came out he laid down like the law. Now beta, now epsilon, now p-value and t. Sampling distributions are easy. Oh, why can't you see? The students, their eyes glazing deep in their head, begged him for mercy. Oh, please, an example instead. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave them to know they had so much to dread. He spoke for so long, they went numb from his words. They all got a headache, even the nerds. Oh, please, Dr. Klepper, at the door they would glance. We must leave right away, but you're still in a trance. It's only 4:20. You must sit a little while longer. The dentist has 10 more minutes, your brain to make stronger. They stammered, they stuttered, their faces went red. For this we pay tuition and go into debt till we're dead? Finally it ended, and away they all flew, the air in the hallway so fresh and so new. But I heard him exclaim, ere he drove out of sight, happy problem sets to all, and to all a good night. And with that, let me invite you to join us in the hallway for a reception to drink, eat, and tell more stories of Steve, wonderful colleague, friend, and family member that he was.